every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do.
Welcome back to another Find Your Purpose Now podcast. I'm so glad that you're here. I'm so excited to share more questions with you. And I hope you're receiving these and really asking yourself these things, because what we're really doing here is we're teasing up out of you the things that are in there and that maybe need to come out. And there are things that you know that just don't come up in everyday conversation. And so with today's questions, I want to kind of tease some of that out of you. So let's just dive right in. So what advice would you give to someone turning 21? They're going out on their own. They're an adult now and they have to start adulting. So what advice do you wish that someone would have given you before you were out on your own? So think about that. The next one, what's your best advice to someone who's getting married? And you know, it doesn't even have to be marriage. It can be really any big life decision that someone's making. What's your best advice about relationships, about life decisions, about marriage? How do you make it work? All those kinds of things. So you have very specific opinions about things based on what you've seen and heard, what you've experienced in your own life. These are the things you know for sure. And they're in there. And sometimes it just takes somebody asking you a question to kind of bring it up out of you. What advice would you give someone who's about to have their first child? What parenting advice would you give? What advice would you give to grandparents, aunts and uncles, anybody who's responsible for another human life and the raising and nurturing of that little person? I'll bet you have some strong ideas about that. What advice would you give to the parent of a child with health challenges or behavioral difficulties? Think about that. What advice would you give to someone who's going to open up their own business, or they want to, or they already did? What advice would you give to that person? What advice would you give, or comment would you make to someone who has been diagnosed with a terminal illness? Let's stop there and let's talk about this. We have messages that have been entrusted to us. They've been formed through the experience train of our lives. We've formed opinions and perspectives based on the context of experiences that we've had. And, you know, I'm not saying we're all 100% right about the things that we know for sure, but there's a reason that we have those things inside of us, those messages, those perspectives, the things that we know for sure. And the people who are in our lives need what we have. There's someone who needs to know what you know. And if you don't know that person, you will. When you are able to articulate, really think through and get a solid answer to these questions, and then really communicate those thoughts to other people, it can be very healing to the other person. It can clear up a very confusing, overwhelming mess in somebody else's head. When you can see clearly, when you can dial down the noise that somebody else is dealing with and and clearly envision a positive outcome to a situation, that's invaluable. So a lot of times people think, I don't have anything profound in me. You're wrong about that. Well, the simplest thing can be truly extraordinary and profound to somebody who needs to hear it. When we are really in touch with who we are, our authentic identity, which is made up of all these different things that, you know, we've talked about before. If you haven't heard all the different things, go back in the podcast and listen to those things about our personality traits, our character traits, our intelligences, all of those things that make us who we are. A big part of it, though, is it is our perspective. It is the context. It's the lens through which we see the world that can really shed light on a problem for someone else when we come along and say, I've been where you are, and I can tell you how I got out of it. And that's a beautiful thing. You know, when we can help somebody like that, we should. Because the purpose for all of us, each of us individually, is really to love others. I mean, the Bible says, God says, love God, love others. Really, it's really simple. Every other rule or guideline around moral and ethical behavior, being a good person, all of it rests on loving God and loving others. I like to say, I love God by loving others, loving His children. It doesn't mean that I have to like every single thing that everybody does and everything that they say, but I try to find the good in people. And then I try to focus on that instead of getting hung up on what our differences are. I think it's incredibly divisive for us to all go through life divvying ourselves up into these groups of socioeconomic differences in ethnicity and color and gender. And I mean, you name it. I had a situation recently that kind of blew my mind. Because I don't divvy people up into groups. And I'm going to a new, I picked a new general practitioner doctor. And so I'm meeting her for the first time. And she's asking me a bunch of questions. And in the process of these questions, I mean, it was all about health. And then suddenly, out of the clear blue, she said, "What's your level of education?" Well, it threw me for a loop because I thought, what does that have to do with whether or not I have allergies and asthma? I don't know. So my answer was kind of flippant. I thought, I don't really want to go into that. It has nothing to do with anything. So I didn't say all that to her. I just said, I'm an autodidact. And she said, oh, well, what's your level of education? And I said, I'm an autodidact. And she said, I don't know what that means. And I said, it means I'm a self-learner. I'm a lifelong learner. She said, oh, okay, I'll put down that you had some high school. And she moved on. And I thought, oh my word. And you could see her face change. And you could, I sensed her, you know, her, I saw the micro expression pass over her face and her body language changed. And I thought, oh, isn't this interesting? She just put me in a box. She made a judgment about me that I don't have her, she's an MD, that I don't have her level of education. Well, I don't, it's fine. And honestly, I don't care what she thinks of me. I really don't kind of care what anybody thinks of me. I mean, obviously we all want everybody to think well of us or whatever, but the point really is that when another person makes some kind of a judgment about us, puts us in a box, whether it's, color race, sexual orientation, gender, you know, whatever, you know, the ways that we divvy ourselves up. When somebody else puts us in a box, not us putting us in a box and making some declaration about who we are or whatever, but somebody else puts us in a box, it doesn't feel good. Now, if somebody puts you in a wonderful box, like they're putting you up on a pedestal, like, oh, you're so amazing or whatever, that feels good. But we don't usually do that, do we? In our culture, in our society, what we tend to do is gather a little bit of information about somebody, and it can be very little. I mean, it can be based on what somebody posted online on social media about whatever their opinion was about, you know, a political candidate or whatever. And suddenly people make a decision about who that person is, knowing very little to nothing about them. Now they're in a box. And there are people who have decided, that's it. I don't like you and I'm never going to like you. And wow, think of the division. That's the opposite. Labeling people and throwing them in a box, in a category, is the opposite of loving people. Now, love doesn't mean that we have to accept every single thing. You know, I would have a hard time loving a serial killer. Could try to find something good about that person, I suppose. But, you know, that's, I'm not trying to, you know, give an extreme case like that. But for the most part, you know, we're not interacting with serial killers on a daily basis, we hope. But think of the times that somebody has dismissed us, or that we've dismissed somebody else because of some perceived separation, distinction. And the reality is, we're all different. We were made differently. That's part of the program. Every single one of us has a different fingerprint, different DNA. Of course, we're going to have different opinions. That's the point. We're supposed to all see things through our own lens and hopefully learn from others. And that's what this series of questions is really all about: learning about ourselves, learning about how to communicate what we think and feel. And hopefully in doing that, we model that for other people and give them the freedom and the permission to share who they are and what they think and what they believe, without freaking out, without labeling people and destroying relationships because somebody's different from us. It's not our purpose. It's not part of our purpose to love only the people who are just like us, or to love only the people who are in, you know, in our world, and everybody outside is, you know, they're outside. We don't love them. We don't care about them. That's not what we're supposed to be doing. See, when we're living our purpose, we're being an influence to the people around us. When we're a good influence, the people around us can expand. That can grow. And maybe it's not necessarily that the people in our lives expand and grow. You know, not all of us have the bandwidth for that. I'm an introvert. I'm an off the chart introvert. I understand overwhelm. But what I do know is that when we positively influence the people around us, now they are equipped to influence the people in their circles. And then those people can influence the people in their circles, and on and on and on it goes. And that's what I mean by expanding our influence. I think we tend to say, I know I'm a good person. I don't know about everybody else. I'm going to, you know, kind of close the gate around me, and I'm going to be very careful about who I let in, because it's a crazy world out there and I don't want any pain. I totally get that. As an introvert, I totally get that. But loving others, loving the people within our influence, whether it's one or 1,000 or anywhere in between or more than 1,000. I have, I think, almost 8,000 contacts in my phone. That's what we're called to do. And loving people, I always say love is action. I wrote a book called Love is Action. I wrote another book, 30 Days to Love. Loving people is not just showing physical affection. It's not hugging them when you see them. I mean, it is that and so much more. A big, big part of loving people is what we do and what we say. Leaving people better off than we found them. Encouraging other people. Giving a word of advice or a word of encouragement. Listening. Just sometimes it's listening. Making sure that other people feel seen and heard. That's love. There are many different love languages. There are things that come easier to you than other things. So whatever it is that comes easy to you, do it. Lean into it. Make an effort to do it. I'm talking to you about these questions to help you to get in touch with what you know for sure. Because I truly believe, I've seen it in my life and many other, the lives of many people within my influence that, somebody somewhere needs the advice about what you know for sure. Somebody's going through something that you've already been through and you successfully survived it. Somebody's going through something or about to step into something that you can see as a potential train wreck and they don't see it. It's in their blind spot. Knowing those things and sharing those things, that's love. That's caring. That's concern. And you can do that. That and every other way that you show love to people. That's what we're called to do. That's how we make a difference. Love is really the only showing love, I should say. The demonstration of love. Acts of kindness. Acts of mercy, forgiveness, patience, putting up with difficult people because they're going through something or they've been through something that really hurt them and made them kind of prickly. All those kinds of things, it's showing love. Not walking away, not shutting somebody out, not just saying, you are just way too much and I can't hang anymore. If you have to take a break, take a break. But don't just write anybody off without showing them the best love that you can show them, loving them in the best way that you know how. You might not see results that you want to see, but even in those cases, you're planting seeds. And God can send somebody else to nurture those seeds. And your action in the life of somebody who's gone through a hard time or who is wounded, broken because of what they've been through, and maybe not behaving well. So on the surface looks like they don't deserve it. They don't deserve your love. They don't deserve your kindness. Okay. The people who don't deserve it need it the most. Don't hold back. Because showing love is not about what the recipient of your love can do for you in return. You scatter the seeds of love. You scatter the seeds of kindness. not expecting anything in return. Now, I will say, I guarantee you that it will come back to you because love always splashes back up on the person who gives it. It might not come from the person you've given that act of kindness to. It might be somebody entirely new that you don't even know yet. But if you'll just do it, you'll see that I'm right. So I want to encourage you. Continue to noodle on these questions. Get more and more comfortable with who you are and what you know for sure. And in the middle of that, let me just add, stay teachable. Because other people know something for sure too. And if you're willing to listen to other people, there will be people around you who have a message for you, a message that you need, that maybe heals a place in your heart. So it's a two-way street, this authenticity, this communication, these real conversations that are so much more meaningful than the weather and the sports scores and what the politicians are doing and all of that kind of thing. I know a lot of people want to talk about that and talk about gossip and, you know, other things that are just completely inconsequential or talk about somebody else. Well, all that is redirection away from purpose, away from meaning in life. And I said in the last podcast, hey, we're going to go deep. Well, we're on the way. We're getting there. Because when you decide to make the 1,440 minutes of your day, every day, count, make them purposeful, make them meaningful, make them potentially life-changing, I can tell you, it just doesn't have anything to do with sports or politics or any of the other things, what's on TikTok, you know, any of the other things that we waste a lot of time thinking about and looking at and talking about. The only thing that you can really control in your life are your thoughts, your attitudes, and your actions. You get to decide what you're going to think, what you're going to believe, how you're going to behave, what you're going to do as a result of those things. So when you, I'm not saying that it's wrong to, you know, have a political opinion. By all means, go vote. But don't make your whole life around that. Don't make your whole life around, you know, whatever some celebrity's doing. Or any of that nonsense, because every minute that you spend focused on stuff that, you know, it's people who are not really part of your life. You're not spending Christmas with them. People who don't care about you, they don't know you, they don't want to know you. If you think of celebrities and politicians and, you know, all these different people in that kind of way, it really kind of helps you to focus on the people who are in your life and who do care about you. And who you care about. And so if you're thinking about those things and about the meaning of your life and their lives and the purpose involved, the things that maybe you can come together and do that make a meaningful difference in the lives of others. Okay, well, now we're talking. You know, now that's going out into the deep because there's faith involved. You don't know how it's going to turn out. There's risk involved. But if you step out, when you start having these conversations, what winds up happening is you're going to step out at some point. Somebody's going to invite you to come along on their path of what they're trying to do, or you're going to throw out something to somebody and they're going to go, oh my gosh, that's exactly what I need to do. Let's do it together. Stuff happens. This is when you move forward. This is when it gets exciting. This is when passion is ignited. It's not some fake phony thing like, you know, you go to a seminar over the weekend and somebody's, you know, screaming at you and trying to get you to learn these positive affirmations and say so many of this every day and, you know, and visualize that and, you know, and hey, you know, there's probably nothing wrong with all that stuff. But if you peel away all of that, the noise and the artificial motivation and all of that, and you really look for the thing that just lights your hair on fire, the thing that just, it clicks with you. And then there are other people who hear what you have to say and it clicks for them too. And that builds your tribe. And then you're all moving forward and making progress in the thing that you care deeply about. And when you make progress, you will get results. And those results spur you on to the next thing. I know for me, I'm in the process right now of the launch of our Prevent Child Trafficking Vegas initiative. Las Vegas is a worldwide destination for child sex trafficking. And it's such a big problem, and it's such a heinous problem that for a lot of people, I think the sort of the natural response to it is just, oh, it's, you know, it's too big. There's nothing I can do about it. I have to focus on what I can do something about. Otherwise, I'll drive myself crazy. Well, the truth is that there is something we can do about it. There are two very specific things. And one is to empower vulnerable kids, kids who are the most vulnerable to the lure of traffickers, empower them so that they're not quite as vulnerable and they know what to look for. And they're skeptical about the person who comes along and, you know, offers them something that's too good to be true. And the other piece is for people in the community, neighbors, to keep their eyes open, to understand what the four most common possible signs of trafficking are, and the one action to take. The national hotline number that's staffed 24/7, 365, and I think it's over 200 languages. And it's a phone number and a text number, and it takes no time at all to report something when you see something that doesn't look quite right. So when I started thinking about, you know, this can be done. It's not too big. It's not too overwhelming. And since we know that it's estimated that the average life expectancy of a child trafficked is 7 years, 7 years. They get killed. They get riddled with disease. If we can save one child or prevent one child from being trafficked, we may very well be saving that child's life. So when I got in touch, my example, when I got in touch with what I really cared about, it lit my hair on fire. Because I used to think, well, the worst thing on earth is child abuse. And then I found out about child abuse for the profit of another. Whew. I thought, okay, this, I have to do something about it. I started by studying the issues, talking to people who were in that space, learning everything I could possibly learn. This is what I'm telling you to do about whatever you care passionately about. Because what happens is when you start going in that direction, you start meeting people who really are your people. And everything starts to change when you find your people and they care about what you care about, or at least they're willing to hear about it. Our Prevent Child Trafficking Vegas initiative now has gathered many, many, many people. I've met so many new people, wonderful, amazing people who are just coming alongside and saying, what can I do? How can we do this together? I'm with you. I want that to happen for you. Whether it's a community initiative, starting your own business, just having a group of friends that really are family. You know, you can create the family that you want to have. I did that because I had to, because I didn't have biological family. My parents were both gone when I was a little girl. But you can have a great big biological family and still just bring people into your orbit and do life with them. And it's a beautiful thing. Life is better when you're living it with purpose and meaning, and the fuel of all of that is love. It's loving other people. It's loving God, trusting God. So, you know, if you don't have these people in your life, if you don't know your purpose, if you don't haven't found your meaning and haven't been able to, you know, figure out why some of the hard things have happened in your life and you're feeling bad about all that, just ask God, show me what you have for me. I want to believe that you have a good purpose for me. Please give me a clue. Give me a glimpse to what your good purpose is for me. Open the doors you want me to walk through. Slam shut the doors that will move me farther away from my purpose. It's important to be willing to do that, I have to say, kind of as an aside, because what we tend in our culture, we tend to decide these are our goals, these are our plans, and we really want God to make our plans happen. We want His seal of approval on what we want to do. And what really needs to happen is we need to ask Him, why am I here? What was I born to do? If it's true what the Bible says about you knew me and approved of me before you knitted me together in my mother's womb, that in Ephesians 2:10, okay, if it's really true, God, that I'm your masterpiece that you created, that when I would partner with Jesus, that I would be fully equipped to do the good work that you perfectly matched me to do before I was even born. Okay, if all that's true, what's the work? What's my part? Open the door. And God will show you. He will. Now, if you ask Him at 1:27 p.m. in the afternoon, you may not have the answer by 1:29, okay? I always say pray and then listen. Pay attention to what happens. It could be a phone call from somebody. It could be an email. It could be a text. It could be a conversation you have with somebody in the elevator. But just when you ask God for an answer, listen for the answer. And it may be a booming sound from the sky, but that's not how it works for me. Your answer may come in some other form. That's okay. Just pay attention. Because the most fulfilling thing in this life is not to, create some artificial goal and try to make it your purpose. But it's to find the real, genuine, authentic purpose that you were born for, that you were perfectly matched to, that when you begin to do it, you cannot fail. Because you were made for it and it was made for you. That's the purpose you want to find. All right, join me again next time. I want to hear from you.
The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do. Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.